Hello and welcome to PostFeature.
Hello, welcome to a wonderful PostFeature. Every week is wonderful here, isn't it?
You pretend to be Superman because you've got that top on.
I don't need to pretend. I am the Man of Steel.
Okay, coming up on the show today, we've got Mission Impossible, Rogue Nation.
Yes.
Also, Hot Pursuit, starring...
So I just loved how you pronounced that. I thought that was lovely. Hot Pursuit. Pursuit.
That's how I talk, Joseph Gunn.
So you play
Hot
Trivial
Pursuit.
Pursuit as well.
Starring Sophia Varga and Reese Witherspoon in a buddy cop comedy type thing. We've got a classical review.
We have got a classical review.
And a trailer of the week.
And a trailer of the week.
Very exciting.
So much. Should we get cracking?
Yes, let's.
Here's a trailer for Mission Impossible Rogue Nation.
Where is Hunt? He's deep cover.
Ready or not.
The Syndicate is real. A rogue nation trained to do what we do.
They're coming after us.
You ready?
You want to bring down the Syndicate? It's impossible.
Oh my God!
Now then.
Yes.
I don't care what anyone says about the Mission Impossible film.
Yeah.
I just love Tom Cruise.
Interesting.
Just because of that, the plane. He actually did that. I mean, that
yes,
is actually him.
Tom Cruise did all of his own stunts in this film. They did actually have a stuntman ready for him, but he didn't get to do anything.
Yeah. Tom Cruise just
apparently
did
he
it
just
all.
Sat there like...
Yeah, he was literally hanging off the side of a plane at heights of up to 5,000 feet because they had to film it 8 times.
Yeah, and it actually happened, and he had to wear a coat of eyeball protecting thing.
Lenses.
That covered his entire eyeball.
Yeah.
So no birds flew in them.
Yeah, and so he could keep his eyes open because obviously that kind of amazing. Anyway, Mission Impossible 5, this is Rogue Nation. It is a continuation from 4.
It follows on directly
Ghost Protocol.
From 4. Doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. And it's interesting because they are coming up against the Syndicate, a kind of anti-IMF.
Yeah, the Syndicate were the original bad guys from the Mission Impossible TV series in the 1960s.
Yes.
So they're kind of bringing that back, and that's really interesting.
Yeah. Do you like it?
Let's discuss. Okay, the film and then Tom Cruise as two separate things because I don't like Tom Cruise. I don't like Tom Cruise.
Mm.
And I think this has an awful lot to do with Tom Cruise being one of our last kind of movie stars.
He is a movie star, yeah.
He is a movie star. But there was an unfortunate incident in 2005.
Yes.
When, you know, things were just starting to take off on the internet. There was an unfortunate incident. It involved a sofa, some jumping, a weird
religion. He was happy. He was happy. You can't not
Point
like
is,
someone being happy.
It all got blown a bit out of control. And it kind of created this idea that we have now as Tom Cruise as slimy, sneaky, and possibly evil person.
You've got to be careful because you may not like the man, but you can't like use that as to why you don't like him in films.
No, exactly. And I think one of the most interesting things about Tom Cruise is that he is fully aware of
him.
How he comes across. He is fully aware you think he's a bit sleazy. So when he was doing serious roles, he didn't quite come across that way because he was playing someone else. Whereas since 2005, I think he's more aware of how he is projected to the world, and he tends to take on roles, I find. In big blockbusters and so on, where he plays that guy that is slightly sleazy.
A slight version of himself, you mean, sort of?
A version of his media persona,
Yes, his media persona, yes, obviously.
I guess he's doing a good job.
Yeah. So, all in all, we like Tom Cruise.
I guess, sort of.
The film, I like the film.
But the film.
I think
Let's
the
talk
film,
about the film.
The film is good. The film is good.
The film's great. I happily...
It's exhilarating. I mean, it's got some great...
I think it's largely Rebecca Ferguson's film.
Yes, she's very good in it,
She's the best thing in this film.
She pretty much steals the show, doesn't she?
She just romps right in there. Also, she's Swedish, did you know?
She is Swedish.
She is Swedish, you could not tell.
Especially with her name as well. It's a very English name. Rebecca Ferguson.
Ferguson.
Yeah, that's what I said. Anyway, so she's really good. Simon Pegg's really good as well. because I like him, because I like they brought him into it more in the last one, because he is good comedy relief, and he does the same job in this one. He is good at the comic relief.
I liked the direction in this film a lot, in that we didn't have too many one-liners.
No, there wasn't.
There weren't a lot of kind of the snappy, let's go back to the one-liners.
Yeah.
Instead, it was like action, 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 action with no words.
Yeah.
Which worked. If that is what you like, if you like a straight action film,
there's
this
less
is
dialogue.
The film for you.
There's less dialogue, wasn't there? Much less dialogue. Anyway, I think we should probably move on to your classical review.
My classical review this week is the 39 Steps.
Why is it the 39 Steps?
Because it is pretty much the best first film about being on the run.
Being on the run.
Which Tom Cruise does a lot of.
There you go. Who would have thought Mission Impossible and 39 Steps? Who would have known?
Running away from government agencies.
Let's have a look.
Robert Towns, screenwriter of Modern Noir Chinatown, once remarked that it's not much of an exaggeration to say that all contemporary escapist entertainment begins with the 39 steps. This Alfred Hitchcock 1935 thriller certainly sets the foundations for the many falsely accused man-on-the-run films we've seen since. Hitchcock, drawing on characters and situations created by John Buchan, in a novel that wasn't much more than pulpy, here creates the classic movie thriller recipe. He throws an amiable, innocent adventurer into a bubbling pot of espionage, then allows the hero to sink so low he appears to be guilty, until finally he rescues his good name and the security of his nation. Dun, dun, dun. The reluctant hero in this case is Richard Hannay, played by Robert Dunnett, a Canadian staying in London who gets into trouble when Secret Service agents kill a glamorous spy in his bachelor flat. Hannay runs to picturesque Scotland to search for the kingpin of the spy network, whilst eluding police who suspect him of the murder.
May I take your place, please?
What are you doing here? I found him in a linen box.
But you can't do anything about it. I've been to Scotland Yard. Nothing whatever has been stolen from the Air Ministry. They're absolutely certain about it.
Have you heard those men say he'd got him? There he is. Shall we take him there, sir? I'll wait till the interval.
What are you going to do? He's not been missing. There's an end to it.
This theme of the innocent man trapped in a web of intrigue was one Hitchcock returned to so frequently, the term Hitchcockian hero became shorthand for such characters. The audience hurtles along with the beleaguered hero through the twisting plot of persecution and redemption fantasy. Enemy agents and police chase our intrepid hero over breathtaking scenery. North by Northwest, The Man Who Knew Too Much, and Saboteur are also among the films showing off his mastery of the technique. The 39 Steps stands out because it was one of Hitchcock's first talkies. As such, it's a little too brash in places, but what stands out is his use of silence or the unheard. In one scene, a crofter mistakenly believes his wife and Hannay are plotting a late-night tryst after seeing them converse, but not hearing what they say. Another Hitchcock motif is clear in the film. When Hannay makes his getaway from London on the Flying Scotsman, he startles a bespeckled blonde, played by Madeleine Carroll, in a train compartment, forcing a kiss on her to fool the cops in the train's corridor. In this era of rampant male chauvinism, Hannay expects her not only to have greatly enjoyed the forced kiss, but also for her to utterly believe his protestations of innocence. But Hitchcock's women don't behave that way. His icy blondes are strong and smart. Pamela won't just take his word. In a taut thriller slapstick mashup, the two end up handcuffed together, with Hannay dependent on her for his freedom. Their odd couple relationship is an erotic version of tough love. Thriller films are either fantasies fulfilled or anxieties purged, but The 39 Steps is both. Our hero is chained to a beautiful girl, but accused of murder at the same time. Hannay might be Canadian, but the film is quintessentially British, and here he fills another fantasy as he saves his country. Hitchcock's able to rouse patriotic feelings without the jingoism that we might see from someone else, and with a master's touch, creates a whodunit throughout which we know exactly who did it, but not why.
I've known what it is to feel lonely and helpless and to have the whole world against me. And those are things that no man or woman ought to feel.
Thank you very much, Jessica.
You're very welcome for that classical review. Now, viewers, here's a little game for you. Did you spot the mistake in the classical review this
yes,
week?
Yes, there were a couple of them. And if you can get it right, you might win a prize.
Ooh.
But you have to wait and find out after the break.
Yes.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to PostFeature. Would you like to explain what the mistakes were there in the classical review?
Yes, our lovely technicians there added in two extra photos that were not from the 39 Steps, but were instead from the Bells of St. Trinian.
They were so clearly from that film as well. It was such a rookie mistake. Like, you could see that they were not from the 39 Steps.
No, that's why we added them in deliberately, isn't it?
You just can't get the staff these days.
Bradley.
Anyway, shall we move on?
Yes.
Instead of name calling. So our next film is Hot Pursuit. But before we get to that, we're just going to touch a little bit more on Mission Impossible. Mm-hmm. I would suggest, well, I presume you're going to say the same. Go to the Odeon and watch Mission Impossible, because it is...
I would say it.
An
go
action
to the Odeon,
romp.
Watch Mission Impossible. I will now be watching other Tom Cruise films.
You got to. Oh, I've not seen a bad Tom Cruise film, to be honest. I actually mean that. I even like Jerry Maguire, and that's like romantic. And I don't do that kind of thing.
Yeah, but again, Jerry Maguire, he kind of plays up to that weird thing about him that makes you think, I hate you.
But I love you. It's a fine line.
The I love you part is just you.
Okay. Right.
Tweet your thoughts, clearly.
Yes, tweet them to us. PostFeature TV, isn't it?
Yes.
At PostFeature TV. Just had to double check with the governor. Hot Pursuit time. Here's a trailer.
She's a federal witness in my protective custody.
I know she looks like she can't protect nothing because she has a mustache.
What a mustache.
And talks like some tiny little robot.
1031, shooting in progress. 1032.
Let me tell you something. She's my tiny little weird robot.
What is this white stuff?
It's baking powder. We're bikers. Toast, muffin, cakes.
Muffin.
This accident's gonna be all jacked up. We need a different identity.
Why do you look like Jose Bieber?
You must be Miguel.
See, yeah, you're Soy Miguel.
I am totally crushing it as a dude.
Oh, yeah, that's your average guy chest.
Nothing there.
Yep, that's right, nothing there.
Hot Pursuit.
This film was awful.
This is one of the worst films in a very long time.
This isn't even a one-star film. This is a half a star.
Half a star.
And that's just for Reese Witherspoon being chirpy.
Yeah, what? Ah.
She's a good sport.
I used to like Reese.
Look at her that.
I used to like her. Like, I've seen her in stuff and I thought, yeah, you can act. And I like you. And then this.
Actually, no, wait. I've decided I'm going to up it to one star for the opening sequence.
The opening sequence, I see.
The opening sequence, which would make a fantastic short film, don't you think?
It probably would have done, actually, yeah. Yeah. They could have just done that.
Little girl growing up in the back of her father's car.
Yeah.
Police car. It's so sweet.
It is,
yeah. And then at the end, oh, and he's gone and she must radio in.
Yeah, it's just
not... Very sweet.
Yeah, it's just the bit in the middle. The hour and a half.
The middle.
In the middle.
By which you mean...
The rest of it.
Whole rest of it.
Yeah, I just don't get it. Like, so, I was trying, I almost wanted to, like, make myself laugh, like, pretend to laugh, just so that
I see why they were going with it. I understand. They were trying for something like The Heat.
Yes.
That kind of female buddy comedy, but it only works if it's good.
Yeah, you got to have a good, I don't even think the story was that good either. It's just like, it's a bit.
No. So, in case you didn't get the story, a man and his wife are being taken into witness protection. He is then killed. Reese Witherspoon must, who is a police officer, very like by the book type of police officer, must then escort his wife to safety.
Yes.
And a safe house or something. Witness
yeah.
Protection, safe house, whatever. Reese Witherspoon, she's chirpy.
She's chirpy, but she's...
She's trying.
Yeah, useless.
Yeah. Sophia Vergara is just...
Oh, wow. She basically plays the same woman as she does in Modern Family.
She just plays the same character all the time.
Yeah, she's basically her. And it just doesn't work. It's just no... Like, the pair of them together just doesn't go at all.
It's not even a funny clash.
Yeah, they just don't work.
They're
There's
mismatched.
No chemistry.
Their comedy isn't... I mean, I understand that Reese is supposed to be the straight woman.
Yeah.
But...
Yeah. Should we show them a clip to see, and they can see what we mean?
Mm.
This is Sophia and Reese trying to be funny.
I know you're mad, but can we just talk about this reasonably?
Honey Bonnie, there you are. I've been looking all over for you.
Who is that?
I am her lover.
What?
We had a little fight, but I'm sure you know who's... fault it was. It's like being in love with some tiny little brick wall.
How the hell you understand her?
I usually don't even know what she's talking about.
But we use body language.
But I'm calling the cops.
No, this is outrageous.
No.
This is Rachel profiling. I can't be a lesbian because she's so unattractive and talks like some tiny little robot. Well, let me tell you something. She's my tiny little weird robot. And I love her.
What are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing?
I'm trying to show him that I love you.
What are you doing?
Distracting him so he won't call the cops.
Yeah, I need to report two suspicious women on my property.
It's not working!
Sexy!
Okay. How sexy? Oh, yeah. Pull my hair. I like that. Yeah, I love it.
The unfortunate thing with this film is not even that it's bad. The unfortunate thing is that big Hollywood studio execs are going to look at this and say, oh, look, well, we tried to do a buddy thing with two women and it didn't work because it's two women and women can't be funny. So we're never going to do that again.
It's a shame because,
it's
to be
honest... It's just one bad film.
Yeah.
It's two actresses whose comedy skills aren't... match.
I mean, if you watch The Heat's funny. No, that's really funny because you've got Sandra Bullock and Melissa McCarthy. Melissa McCarthy, obviously, she's wonderful. Bridesmaids, obviously, that's all fair. That's like one of the funniest films for the last few years, at least. It's brilliant. It's a great film.
It's just very unfortunate. This film is so incredibly bad.
It is a shame.
So let's move on to the trailer of the week.
Let's move on to the trailer of the week.
Please.
Yeah. Now this, I didn't actually expect this to come out. To be honest, after the first one, it's been a long time. Yeah. I just didn't see it happening. No. But this, ladies and gentlemen, is Zoolander 2.
In the beginning, there was nothing, an infinite void. Then, in an instant, everything known to man came into being. The Big Bang, the birth of time itself, chaos and beauty, a beauty that created infinite galaxies, galaxies that would one day create the unimaginable, life, but even more incredible, the human brain, a brain that possesses the power of reason, and the ability to ponder life's most ancient riddles. Or the one question that has puzzled mankind since the beginning of time.
If God exists, then why did he make ugly people?
There you go. Who would have thought it, eh? Zoolander 2.
I know. It's a very risky thing to do, though.
It is.
To make a second Zoolander.
It is risky. Yeah, Dumb and Dumber was an example of that, wasn't it?
Mm.
You know, what was it, 20 years after the first one, they made a second one? I laughed. I found it funny.
I didn't.
A lot of people hated it, though, so, you know, it is a risk.
You're definitely playing with fire if you're taking something that people still reference today. People still do Blue Steel.
Yeah, of course.
It's still a joke. So if you're then going to add on top of that, are you going to be ruining it?
Mm.
Are you diminishing the original franchise? Or...
you've got to be careful.
If it's really good, are you, you know, creating something fabulous.
I still don't know what that is.
I'm not sure what you are doing.
Don't do it.
Obviously, that relates. We can relate that back to Mission Impossible.
We can, yes, because
and it's 4 sequels.
Yeah, there's been a lot of them, and whilst it is good, and the new one is good, you know, you've got to think like you've got to stop at some point. And what worries me nowadays is that films just continue to be made just for financial gain, not for credibility to what they've made before.
The great thing with something with a book series, for example, like Harry Potter or The Hunger Games, we know it will finish.
Yes.
We know it will stop. They're not going to make another Harry Potter film.
No. There's going to be spin-offs, though, probably, isn't there?
There isn't a film.
Yeah.
There isn't a book to base it on. So good, it's done. Let's not keep playing with it. I hate that. Let's not tinker with something.
You got to be careful with all that kind of stuff.
But, on the other hand, I also quite happily watch old films, and not everyone does.
Yes, that's also true. I do think horrors are a little bit outside of that realm, though, because obviously you got like, you know, Nightmare on Elm Street, there's like 400 of those and everyone still loves it. I don't know why horrors get away with it.
I think get away with it because if you're going to remake a horror, you're going to be using better special effects, you're gonna have a lot more money
than
you did with the first one, which was a surprise hit type thing. And people nowadays, we are expecting different things. We're expecting it to look realistic and awful.
There you go. Perfect.
Realistic and awful.
Just what we wanted to hear. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. That is all for this week.
And we shall see you next week.
Bye-bye.